So we've all heard about, you know, is Satanism involved in Hollywood? Are there messages in your movies and TV shows? Well, just might be the case. Welcome to the show, folks. My name is Josh Tully. This is The Josh Tully Show on the GCN Radio Network. If you want to be part of it today, 1-800-259-5791, 1-800-259-5791. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Google+, all those fun social sites, and of course the website, joshtolley.com, joshtolley.com. While you're there, make sure you grab a copy of Evangelpreneur, and thank you to everybody who has made that the number one free enterprise book in the entire country. I so appreciate that. Thank you so much. All right, so today we have a very interesting show. You know, it is a very rare occasion that we keep a guest on for the entirety of a show, but this is one of those cases. And the reason why is because I have felt for a long time that entertainment is a massive influence in the lives of our children, in the lives of us, for goodness sakes. I mean, every day we tend to speak in movie quotes. I mean, if we were to say there's no crying in baseball, everybody knows that that's Tom Hanks. If we were to say take the red pill or the blue pill, I mean, we use that on a daily basis. So I wanted to get beyond the headlines. I wanted to get beyond the box office and really dig into, is there really a satanic influence? Is there a cult influence in movies? Or is that just a bunch of hype and buzz and fear porn? And to talk about that, we have John Robertson. Now, John is one of the fellow speakers at the Hear the Watchmen conference that we're going to be doing later this week. Go to hearthewatchmen.com. If you can make it in person, definitely do so. But if you can't, we are going to be streaming it as well, so you can watch the live stream. John, welcome to the show, my friend. How are you doing?
Oh, Josh, thank you so much for having me on this morning. I guess we're closing in on afternoon in the central time zone, still enjoying a beautiful morning up here in the Pacific Northwest. You know, Josh, I've been a regular listener of the Josh Tully Show for a number of years now, and it's always just such a cool thrill to jump on a new platform and just dig into Hollywood and some current events and what's going on that's really, like you said in the introduction, shaping, I would say, the minds and hearts of the greater portion of our nation. But also, I firmly believe conditioning moviegoers and television viewers for the ultimate elitist, even New World Order, if you will, agenda that we're actually witnessing unfold day by day.
You know, I agree with you. And as we get into this, somebody's going to say, okay, well, you know, there's YouTube videos talking about this and everybody's got a conspiracy theory. But you kind of have an interesting background. You're just not somebody who says, well, I watched Wizard of Oz and I saw the person hanging in the tree. You've actually done this sort of stuff. I mean, you're in the industry. Give everybody kind of a snapshot of who you are and where you're from.
Oh, thank you so much, Josh. I will do that. Moved to Hollywood in 1998, and what motivated me from San Francisco down to Hollywood was something that, you know, I don't even talk about this socially too much because it just sounds too over the top. But what happened, Josh, is I met just by complete, I don't really believe in coincidence anymore, but perhaps the Lord led us to our initial contact. But I met Mark Polish back in the early 90s, and Mark and Michael Polish make films as the Polish Brothers. They've made a number of great films, including Twin Falls, North Fork, Jackpot, and the adaptation of the Jack Kerouac novel, Big Sur.
Oh, sure.
And so I met Mark Polish when I was living in Marin County, north of San Francisco. And I was doing I was really jumping into creative writing at the time. I was banging out a lot of short stories and really getting into finding my feet with poetry. Writing every day, and I met Mark, and after he read some of my work, he brought me into a collaboration for a spec screenplay that he and his brother Michael were working on at the time. So through the winter of 93-94, we wrote a screenplay, and I then moved to San Francisco. They were living in Hollywood at the time. I continued to write screenplays, and the script that we worked on in that winter, 93-94, flash forward about 9 years, it was independently produced as their third feature film production, and it was distributed ultimately by Sony Pictures Classics. Unfortunately, Writers Guild of America has very strict rules about what portion of a screenplay each individual writer has to contribute. And I came in just under that. So it's always been a bittersweet accomplishment. I still have a good rapport with the Polish brothers. I did not get credited for the film. The film is North Fork, and it stars Daryl Hannah, Ray Liotta, and Kyle MacLachlan. So that motivated me down to Hollywood.
Okay.
I came down writing like crazy, had some initial success, met with Ed Solomon, who at the time was riding the wave of the first Charlie's Angels film that he wrote and produced. And got a number of great meetings. But, you know, in Hollywood, Josh, you can write screenplays, you know, till the cows come home and you throw them against a brick wall. And unfortunately, at the end of the day, what you have is litter. Everybody down there has got a script. So long story short, I was working in a real hot napkin deal restaurant in Beverly Hills called Kate Mantellini. Unfortunately, it closed last year, but it was really central to the filmmaking machine. Now, we use Hollywood colloquially, but really most of the pre-production goes on either in Beverly Hills or Culver City or really over on the west side. And Kate Mantellini was right on Wilshire Boulevard in Beverly Hills. We were across the street from ICM. William Morris was two blocks away. The Writers Guild Theater was directly across from the restaurant. So it was a hot napkin deal joint. A lot of fun to work in. I was in my mid to late 20s, you know, met everybody. And from there, I was able to segue into production work. And I started working in the visual aspect of creating the sets and getting involved in art direction and production design. And ultimately worked for some pretty big names. I did Catch Me If You Can for Steven Spielberg. Sure. Worked on the first Pirates of the Caribbean for Bruckheimer. And I've worked for Joel Silver. And let's see. Oh, my goodness. I did 5 seasons of Alias with J.J. Abrams. So I've been blessed, Josh, to work with some of the top names, top talent. I don't know how many projects I've done at this point. I think it's maybe 120, 130. Really run the gamut. I've commercials, music videos for clients like, you know, Toyota, Mitsubishi, KFC, Pepsi. Music videos. I did a bunch of Stone Temple Pilots stuff back in the day. Some Shakira. Some up-and-coming indie bands in the early aughts like Puddle of Mud. So it's been a lot of fun, and that's a long-winded quick bio for you.
No, that's really good, because what it does is it establishes that credibility, you know, because in this modern age, anybody with a blog talk show can say, oh, well, look at this. But the ability to say, you know what, this is what I've done and this is where I'm from. So what was it, or when was it, that first got you thinking, okay, there's something wrong in Hollywood? Because obviously you move there with the same sort of ideals that we have, you know, Hollywood, and it's going to be awesome. But what changed that idea where you said, okay, something 7 flavors of nuts here? So,
I like the way you put that. It's a great question, Josh, and I'll answer it this way. I've never been a big fan of the term that we all use, quote unquote, awake, but I don't know what else to call the realization coupled with discernment spiritually that brings people like your listeners and certainly the congregants around the Hagman and Hagman Report, Caravan to Midnight, True Sure. News, etc., that brings us to this awareness that things are not as they seem. Now, for me, Josh, without going into too much detail, I got on the path to awakening to the realities of the. I hate to say global conspiracy, but we can touch on that a little bit more in a moment.
Yeah, we're gonna.
I did it through finding out who James Wesley Rawls is, the writer who penned a series called the Patriot series, and he also has written a couple of nonfiction books, including How to Survive the End of the World as We Know It. And I heard Rawls on Coast to Coast back in 2009.
Oh, wow!
I read his book Patriots, and excuse me.
Yeah, no worries. Actually, this is actually a great time to take a break, because we're about to go into a break anyway, and before we get into something deep, let's just get that commercial out of the way. So, folks, stay where you're at. We'll be back right after this. All right, we're talking to John Robertson. Now, if you're just joining us, we're confirming your worst fear that, yes, there is a plan, a scheme behind your favorite Hollywood movies and shows. Now, John, before the break, you were kind of getting us into the John Wesley Rawls thing, the entrance you had into realizing something was messed up here. Can you just pick up and run with it?
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Josh. So James Wesley Rawls wrote a book called Patriots. And just to summarize it very briefly, it's about a group of very normal people who go to, I believe, Northwestern in Chicago. And after watching a dystopian film one night, they're all in their mid-20s, they determined that it wouldn't be a bad idea to make some preparations in case there was ever trouble in the country, anything from, God forbid, a nuclear war to something with probably greater impact, but less talked about, like an EMP knocking out the power grid or even an economic implosion. And as I read that book, what really grabbed me was that James Wesley Rawls wrote the book in the early 90s. He had been a captain in Army intelligence, and he had been studying the fragility factor of Central and South American countries using a template that examined things like per capita income, number of calories consumed per day, number of family members, multi-generational households, car Sure. ownership, et cetera. And of course, at the time, we were very concerned about El Salvador and Nicaragua. Before he retired his commission, Josh, he used that same template to examine the United States. And what he determined was bone chilling. The United States actually had a greater susceptibility factor to communism than the Central and South American countries that the Army intelligence was looking at that time. Honduras, Belize, et cetera, Panama. And so that inspired James Wesley Rawls to write Patriots. And what I took, the main thing I took with me from the book, it's his first effort, so I'm not tagging it as amazing literature with no disrespect intended. However, it's very worth reading. He took probably a couple hundred pages of hardcore preparedness reference material that very few people would read, and he constructed a page-turner novel around it. And what I personally took from it, Josh, was the realization, I followed the money, and I realized when I began to understand the story of the Federal Reserve, when I began to understand that the Federal Reserve is a private corporation, as is the IRS, and interestingly, they were both foisted on the American public around the same time, 1913 to 1916, respectively. When I realized, Josh, and it took 3 or 4 months for this to sink in, when I realized that the currency we carry in our wallets is not only rife with Luciferian symbolism and meaning, but it's all debt-based. And in fact, if the debt of the United States of America were retired, we would have no currency. Now, I would encourage your listeners to really, if they can find time in their schedules, take a few moments if you're not up to speed on what I just said and research it, folks, because if the debt of the United States of America were retired, outside of anything other than a jubilee under the ancient Hebraic law, there would be no currency. Because every dollar we carry is not based on gold or silver, it's based on debt.
Yeah.
So my first few steps down the journey of 1,000 miles, so to speak, was following the money. And later in the show, Josh, with your permission, I'll talk a little bit about my effort at Hear the Watchman. The title of my presentation is All Roads Lead to Babylon. And certainly we will cover the Federal Reserve for the folks that are able to attend Hear the Watchman or view it on the live stream. So I was working in Hollywood at the time. I was working on the show Chuck for Warner Brothers.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
I worked on Chuck. I did season 2 and we were over at Warner Brothers, and that was the same crew that did Alias, Mission Impossible 3, Daredevil, and Rush Hour 2, I believe. I've worked with that crew a lot. They're a great crew. They're actually the crew that does Pretty Little Liars over at Warner Brothers right now. And I worked with them for 3 seasons on that show. So I was working on a show about spies and about the sort of making a comic relief of what I call the rapidly growing infrastructure of the massive surveillance grid that is coming down on all of our heads here in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
So on my free time, I would get wrapped off the set every day, and Warner Brothers had really fast internet connection. So I'd sit in the office and I would educate myself, and I figured out who Steve Quayle was, and I started looking at the National Inflation Association and figured out who Alex Jones was, and And not too long thereafter, I started listening to your show. And of course, when you go on this meteoric, you know, almost vertical learning curve, it's impossible not to apply it to all the other aspects of your life. And I began to realize with great trepidation that I was, first I looked at it on a secular level, that I was serving this global banker elitist agenda by lending my craft and creativity to their conditioning. And then as I began to renew my faith in Jesus Christ, I realized, Josh, that not only was I complicit in this, but that I was at very minimum a competent saucier in Satan's kitchen. And you could say that when that realization hit me in both mind and spirit, the clock was ticking.
So where does it take that divergence then? Because a Hollywood producer by the name of Aaron Russo, who made a bunch of Eddie Murphy's movies, he made a great film called America, Freedom to Fascism. And it talks about the Federal Reserve and how, you know, none of our income tax actually goes to the government. It goes to pay the interest. But to go from a political system to then say, okay, there's a spiritual or even a more sinister element to this, where did that bridge come from?
Well, I'll tell you what. I'd like to answer it this way. I'll tell a quick story. I'm going to do this off the top of my head. If folks want a more comprehensive description of what I'm about to share, Doug and Joe Hagman and myself did a show, I think it was June 24th of last year, June 24th, 2015, on the Hagman and Hagman Report. And I really covered this in a very comprehensive manner. But Josh, where the Luciferian agenda in Hollywood began is no less than the creation of Hollywood itself. And to understand that, you have to go back to New York City around the turn of the century, when a lot of young, tough kids from the Lower East Side, these were tough Jewish kids, young men, most of whom were being raised by the maternal side of their families. Unfortunately, at the turn of the 19th to 20th century, we're talking about a crossroads of industry. You know, it's the dawning of electricity, but still in ensconced in the age of steam.
Sure.
You've got early automobiles, but you've also got the constant clip-clop of dray wagons and horses in all the major cities. And what came about via Edison and to a lesser degree Tesla, their innovations brought the early motion pictures, which were really short films. They were obviously silent films. We're talking 1905, 1910. And these young Jewish entrepreneurs, again, mostly from the Lower East Side, they began to rent storefronts and they created Nickelodeons. And I'd like to pause for a moment because, again, this goes back to the Luciferian impetus of all of this. But, Josh,
actually,
Nickelodeon...
John, your pauses are wonderfully timed. I swear you have a program clock. So with that pause, we're going to enter another break. And I'm sure, like, people are sitting here wondering, wait a second, is this actually happening? Are we really getting to the root of Hollywood? And the answer is we absolutely are. Stay where you're at. All right, we're talking to John Robertson, and we're talking about Hollywood and the influence it has and what sort of powers have influence over it. And, John, before the break, you were getting to New York Nickelodeons, and if you could please, sir, pick up where you left off and run with it again.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Josh. Yes, we were talking about the migration from New York to the West Coast, but I am getting ahead of myself. We're talking ultimately about the beginning of Hollywood and how it has really been a Luciferian agenda since day one. So here's how it went. Nickelodeon in and of itself says so much about how the initial capital, the seed money for Hollywood, was created. They were called Nickelodeons because the cost of admission was a nickel. But you've really got to look at the word Odeon. It is, I believe, Koine Greek, and it is the Greek god, little g god, of the theater. In ancient Greece, Odeon was considered the little g god that was the roof or the protective platform over the theater. So we have a quote-unquote Luciferian deist origin already, and we haven't even gone to the West Coast yet. Nickelodeon. 5 cents with the little g God. We know that there is only one true God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, any other quote-unquote God can only come from one other place, and that is from Luciferian deception. Back to these tough Lower East Side Jewish kids. They were raised primarily by their mothers and grandmothers, and many of them, including Adolf Zucker, who founded Famous Players Lasky, which ultimately became Paramount Pictures. It was the largest production company of its time. There was a great influence in the Max Sinek studios of Kabbalah, because these what happened was these Lower East Side entrepreneurs, they were in a chokehold, in a financial chokehold, because the only way they could get the films to screen in their little storefronts was to do business with the innovators and the keepers of the monopoly, if you will, in New York City. I'm speaking about Kodak, Edison, Tesla, and I would say to a lesser degree, Marconi. Without his innovations in sound technology, we would have no motion picture today. You could not buy a scrap of film in New York City without doing business with Kodak. You couldn't get your hands on a projector or a camera without doing business over in New Jersey with Edison. So what these young kids did, they were street kids. They were tough. They were kind of a take no guff type of attitude. Pockets bulging with money from these Nickelodeons. Some of them owned up to 30 or 40 at one time. They jumped on a train, Josh. They went west and they found the orange orchards of Southern California. But now this is where it gets interesting. Again, they were not all of them, but many were very well studied in Kabbalah, in Jewish mysticism, and in numerology. And they knew more than almost anyone in our modern age about the occult and the ancient rituals and rites therein. And so what I need to do for a moment is take your viewers and listeners back to the 10th century in what is now the United Kingdom, Scotland, England, Wales, and Ireland. And let's use Stonehenge as an example. In the 10th century, the most practiced occult in the what would become the United Kingdom was that of Druidism, mm-hmm. worship of Mother Gaia, worship of the earth. And most of the Druidic rituals and rite revolved around crop rotation as their primary food source. So they would go to places like Stonehenge and other intersections of ley lines. That's a whole other topic we won't get into today. But they would go to these intersections of magnetic energy on the earth, Stonehenge being one of them, and they would perform incantations and druidic ritual and rite. And I'm fairly studied in it, but I don't like to talk about it on air. And as they would bring about these spells, these incantations, a very important punctuation mark to the incantation was the waving of the wand. Now, we tend to trivialize wands as being sort of, you know, a Halloween costume accessory, sure. or Potter or something like that. But the wand was a very important implement to punctuate and to bring about the casting of the spell or the incantation. In fact, Russ Dizdar, who will be at Hear the Watchman, talks about this a lot. They call it dirtying the air. And interestingly, there are paintings that show druids gathered at their sacred place, creating these beautiful orbs of light around them. It's called in modern parlance dirtying the air, but also Doc Marquis has some great insights into this as well. So it's still performed today. And a very important date to the druidic occult is the winter solstice. And the reason why, Josh, is because it's the longest, coldest day of the year, particularly in northern latitudes like you know, 10th century England.
Sure.
Gray, dark, wet, skeletal trees, no life, except for one tree, and that's called the Toyon, T-O-Y-O-N, the Toyon tree. Now, the Toyon tree remains green throughout this barren time in late December, the winter solstice. And so for that reason, the Druids, the worshippers of Mother Gaia, they took the tree, the Toyon tree, as a symbol of the end of the longest day of winter, then capitulating over to the birth of spring, the reawakening of their little g god, Gaia, the Earth, and of course the beginning of the planting season. Okay, in America, we call the Toyin tree the holly tree. And Josh, the Druids were insistent on a number of procedures for their incantations to have effect. And one of them was their wands were consistently made from the wood of the Toyin tree. Again, that tree in America is called the holly. Well, back to our Lower East Side entrepreneurs. They came out west for 4 to 6 days on a train. They've got plenty of cash. They're ambitious. Got a criminal streak in them. Definitely Machiavellian pragmatists and well studied in Kabbalah. They knew when they got to what would become, you know, when they got to Greater Los Angeles, they knew what they had, the potential that it had to shape everything for many generations to come. They knew, Josh, that they had in their hands no less than the largest wand, the greatest ability to cast spells in the history of humanity. And wow. By having this knowledge, they decided to name their new digs Hollywood. It would be the biggest spell cast on humanity, and it remains so to this day.
Get out of town. That, see, this whole time, I thought Hollywood was named after the racehorse What's-His-Face won a bunch of money on, and you just kind of put a hole in that myth for me. And what's so interesting about that is every year we do a Christmas special, wink, wink, exposing those sort of background cultural influences. But so let me ask you this then. So that's where Hollywood started. You know, there's that influence. But does that mean that the Warner Brothers or Mr. Mayer or any of the, like, were these guys involved in that? Or are we talking even a generation prior to that?
Well, it's interesting that you would ask. I read a great book in late 2015 called Tinseltown. I do not recall the author's name, but he did a fantastic job chronicling the early days of Hollywood from the silent era up into the roaring 20s. And Josh, I think that, well, it says in the Bible that by our fruits we will be known.
Sure.
A little paraphrase there. So let's look at some of the fruits of early Hollywood. We're talking about the teens and early 20s. Heroin addiction was rampant. Shooting liquid cocaine was very popular. Opium dens were everywhere. Homosexuality was, both with men and women, was all the rage. In fact, it was considered very, very in vogue, much as it is today. Unfortunately, there were a lot of child stars, particularly working for famous players Lasky and or Max Sinnott Studios, and of the men with any power or...
Hey, John, hold on 1 second, John. We're up against a break. We'll continue this on the other side, folks. So much to cover. We'll be right back. All right, we're talking to John Robertson. We're talking about Hollywood, and we're getting to the point where we start to get into what I would consider the Gilded Era. I mean, we're now influencing the 20s and 30s, and you were talking about heroin, drug use, child stars. It doesn't seem like that has changed much, John.
No, I indeed it hasn't, Josh, and thank you for that segue, because... again, scripture tells us, let me talk just quickly first about the characteristics of Satan, okay? Lucifer, which was Satan's name before his pride overwhelmed him and he decided to become greater than the Lord God, he was Lucifer. Now, Lucifer is a spinoff of the Latin word lux, which is the bringer of light. Lucifer is noted in the Bible as the morning star, the bringer of light, and he can appear in angelic form if he chooses. This whole New Age thing about being visited by angels is very satanic and very dangerous, but I digress. So let's talk about the five characteristics of Lucifer as we know them through scripture. He is an accuser. Mm-hmm. He is a liar. He is a counterfeiter. He is a thief, and he is a murderer. And as we move through the remainder of the program, I would encourage all of the Josh Tolley Show viewers and listeners to consider this. Lucifer, Satan, cannot create.
Right.
He can only counterfeit that which is given to us by the ultimate creator, which is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Therefore, when you examine Hollywood, you need to do so through the lens of understanding the perpetual counterfeit of Lucifer. It drives him crazy that he can't create. And what really beguiles him is that God gave each of us a little divine spark of creativity, Josh. It's what motivated you to write this smash book, Evangelpreneur, and it's what motivated the inception of the Josh Tolley Show. It's what motivates me to get up every day and put it all on the line to do this. God gave us that divine spark of creativity. It drives Satan nuts, and that's why he's out to accuse us, lie to us, steal from us, and ultimately, if he can, steal our lives. And that is the lens that I would encourage everyone to view Hollywood through, and it is certainly the lens that I now view Hollywood through. Thank you. You know, it's Josh, to be honest, look, I like movies. Okay. I love period pieces. I watched that film last night called The Help. I know it was an adaptation of a book. Thought it was a great film, you know, very emotionally stirring, and it was historical. It was accurate. Great film. So I like movies. I love the smell of popcorn. I like, you know, sinking into the seat in the dark theater. For that matter, I like rock and roll, you know, but unfortunately, when you look at the mass manipulators in our society, be it music, hip hop, particularly at this time, film, movies, video games, television, you know, Anton LaVey back in 1971, Josh said, and I'm paraphrasing, I'm going to touch on this at Hear the Watchman, by the way, but Anton LaVey said that television is the new family altar for the new religion of Satanism.
Yeah.
And he said that in 1971. And he went on to suggest that his Church of Satan, that was in San Francisco at the time, which a lot of stars, including Sammy Davis Jr., were a direct part of, that they encouraged promiscuity and sex among underage, you know, minors. And he suggested that as television, quote unquote, progressed, that we would see this expand to where, and this is almost a direct quote, to where all viewers of television accepted deviation and perversion because all of us are deviants and perverts. So I pose this question to all the listeners and viewers. From Anton LaVey's statement in 1971 to today, was he accurate?
Oh, absolutely. You know what's funny about this? I was doing a show, I think, a week or two ago about modesty and how that's changed and how the guy who invented the bikini had to hire hookers to model it because no model would model the thing. But now we have dads buying them for their 8-year-old daughters at Walmart, and we think nothing of it. And it's crazy. I mean, it's literally having your kid go outside in their underwear. It's waterproof underwear. But we have allowed that diversion to be so subtly accepted that we now accept bad as good, and we consider good prude. And this was all warned against. I mean, it's just nuts. But I got to ask you this. I mean, it goes beyond just the idea of perversion. That's obviously there, and it's prevalent. But what's really kind of scary is how media seems to be predictive, and not just in a sci-fi sort of, you know, Captain Kirk was using a cell phone sort of way. I mean, like, the time that the clock stops in the Matrix is 9/11. The announcement, for goodness sakes, on The Simpsons of Donald Trump running for president. That was crazy. It actually plays to the T, including the little girl dropping her sign, and it swings twice before it hits the ground. How is that even possible?
Well, thank you for that question. These are great questions. To answer that, you know, we've got to examine, and again, I would encourage all the listeners to take a moment to do this. Take a really good hard look at what many people consider to be the father of the quote-unquote Illuminati, and this would be a different show, but the Illuminati, as understood in Hollywood, are really practitioners of witchcraft, and they do not call themselves the Illuminati. Depending on what level of the 13 levels of the pyramid, they subscribe to or they are a part of, they typically call themselves initiates or the initiated. As a quick side note, folks, whenever you hear the word initiate or initiated or even chosen, you need to really have your spiritual discernment tuned to a high frequency, because Christians and those of the Judeo-Christian faith in Christ are received. Witchcraft witches and those who would partake in that evil, be it Skull and Bones or any of the other secret societies and or covens, sure, which, by the way, are strategically built like a corporate infrastructure across the country. They are initiated. They are initiates. So anyway, I digress. We were talking, you mentioned, Josh, the modesty issue with youth. I used to work for Salem, the Salem Radio Network.
Sure.
In LA. And I worked side by side with Dennis Prager. I wasn't part of his show, but he would broadcast from our studios. And Dennis Prager has been a great insight into the question of modesty in our society, and certainly as represented by Hollywood for many years now. And I will tell you just a quick personal story. I'm sure your listeners remember when Miley Cyrus, a.k.a. Hannah Montana, now you mentioned the Simpsons and you mentioned some of the obvious conditioning that comes out. I remember when she came out with her twerking thing and she was, you know, sticking her tongue out and had her hair rolled up in the Baphomet-like horns. I was working on a kid's show for Disney at the time, and I was in a unique position. I was actually running a crew that was responsible for the visual representation of all the sets. And I was working with camera operators and electricians and a lot of the production crew who had been on the entire run of Hannah Montana. And it was an interesting onset hypocrisy to witness, Josh, because whereas these very decent people, hardworking people, were disappointed to see where Miley Cyrus had ended up, if you take the lens or the template of understanding this globalist agenda and what is often called the Overton window, which is simply the elitists moving us two steps forward and one step back, three steps forward and two steps back, giving us false victories, giving us controlled opposition. And what we don't realize is that we're continually moving across the spectrum to whatever end game they have in mind. That when you even look at Hannah Montana, for example, you can see that it's no mistake or fluke that Miley Cyrus represents herself the way she does now. All you have to do is look at Hannah Montana. Hannah Montana was about nothing less than what Russ Dizdar calls multiples, split personalities coming out of Project Monarch and Project Bluebird. The other thing, I digressed off of something though, Josh, if you can help me out. You mentioned, I was going to talk about the father of the Illuminati.
Yeah.
Folks, take a look at Adam Weishaupt. Weishaupt, Adam Weishaupt. He wrote in the late 18th century, and in fact, he published the original instruction manual, if you will, of the Illuminati or Enlightened Ones, reference right around the time that our Declaration of Independence was signed. In fact, it was within just a couple of months of each other. And what Adam Weishaupt said at the time, and I'm paraphrasing, is that certainly they would need to use all printed material, painting, poetry, theater to realize their goals, to realize their end game. And so if we take that and modernize it from the late 18th century to the early 21st century, you could translate that to internet content, video, podcasts, film, television, webisodes, etc. So anyway, I didn't want to leave that Adam Weishaupt part dangling.
Yeah, no worries. And that's actually a great place to pause because we're at the end of the hour. We have a whole nother hour left. And this whole idea of, is there somehow messages left in these efforts? That's illuminating too in a bad way. We'll be back right after this. All right, second hour, Josh Tully Show, GCN Radio Network, 1-800-259-5791. JoshTully.com is the website. Evangelpreneur is the book. PurpleMonkeyUniversity.com is the school. Get tickets to whatever events we're doing. Speaking of tickets to events, we have a very, very special guest with us today, John Robertson. Now, he's going to be another speaker at this conference that I've been telling you about for months. It's called Hear the Watchman. You go to hearthewatchman.com. And you can sign up to attend the event live. If you do, just enter the discount code Josh. They'll give you $50 off the ticket. If you can't make it for some reason, fear not. You can actually stream the thing live from wherever you happen to be. And that live feed is actually going to be good for, I think, 2 months or something afterwards. So even if you're like, oh, man, I got to work, don't worry about it. Get the stream anyway and watch it later. So, John, before we get back into this, I want to ask you, what are you going to be talking about at this conference?
Oh, man, I'll tell you what, Josh. Let me put on my big boy pants here. I am so excited. I'm up in the Pacific Northwest. I fly out at O-Dark 30 on Thursday. And I have put a ton of work into the presentation that I'll be sharing with the people. And I'm one of the first up. So I'm going to...
Nice.
The title of my presentation, as I mentioned at the top of the first hour, is All Roads Lead to Babylon. And this is what I'll share with your listeners and viewers. Imagine... You know the old expression, all roads lead to Rome.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it doesn't take a great leap of a great intellectual leap to realize that we are in an economic implosion. I can't even read most of what mainstream media writes about the economy anymore, except to say this: what we used to hypothesize, Josh, back in 2011 and 12, is now splashed across the front page of the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and USA Today. So. Even the dinosaur media is starting to pick up on the fact that we are in deep doo-doo economically.
Yeah.
And that being said, I would encourage people to visualize very simply a 10-speed tire, a 10-speed bicycle tire, and consider the hub, our country, what was once the greatest country in the world. In fact, we're the only country other than Israel that has an actual covenant with God. That's the Mayflower Compact, signed November 11, 1620. And I will touch on that in my remarks. We have a covenant with God that as we took each step onto this new land, that it would be to glorify and evangelize the message of Jesus Christ, the gospel, salvation, the free gift. And for about 150 years, Josh, that's exactly what this nation did. We beat back Nazism. We beat back imperialism. We freed captive people all over the globe. And the only thing we asked, and I know it's cliche, but it's true, was just enough terra firma to bury our dead. I come from a military family that goes all the way back to the Civil War. We can directly trace ancestors that rode with Mosby for the Confederacy. And I am submitting to the attendees of Hear the Watchman, as well as those who choose to pick it up on live stream, that all roads lead to Babylon. So I'm posing three ideas. Number one, I'm hypothesizing that the United States is in fact Mystery Babylon, as described in Revelation 17, 18. That's a controversial hypothesis, I realize, but I'm going to take that and use it as a foundation to then suggest that if in fact we are Mystery Babylon and we fit the 34 criteria as laid out in Scripture, then what role does Hollywood play in the development, mentally and spiritually, first and foremost, and then lastly, the actual physical development of Mystery Babylon?
Yeah.
Now, I use Babylon both figuratively and literally, and I am taking six of the major avenues, if you will, roads that we see in the news today. We're talking about GMOs poisoning us in our food, fluoride and hydrofluorosilicic acid poisoning us in our water. We're talking about heavy metals being sprayed over all major metropolitan areas in this country and the direct correlation between aluminum sulfate, for example, and Alzheimer's, which is up 1,500% in the last couple of years.
Yeah.
Talking about, I'll be touching on the Federal Reserve and how when we disconnected our currency from what the Bible says are just weights and measures, when we stood in defiance of God's instructions and we decoupled in 1971 from the bimetallic standard, that was really one of the key markers in the road to I believe bringing this nation from a spiritually anointed and blessed land that brought the greatest inventions to humanity of all time. I mean, everything from the internet to the airplane, and brought us to where we're at today, where it kills me to say this, Josh, but we're not a representative republic anymore.
No.
you know, I'd like to make up some political T-shirts that say Darth Vader for president. You know, we're the evil empire, man. We're not the good guys anymore. I think you know we probably need a Chewbacca. So that's what I'm going to be touching on, and then I'm going to use everything. Will come back to Hollywood and to the conditioning machine that Hollywood is. And of course, when you examine that conditioning machine, Josh, you have to look at what is the root of it. And there's only, this is a dichotomy that so many people deny, and they do so at literally their own peril, spiritually in their lifetimes and eternally as well. There's a war that's gone on since the beginning of humanity, and it rages around us every day. And that war is fought between the Lord God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who loves each of us, created us fiercely in his own image, mm-hmm. battling against the wicked death cult that is the satanic agenda. And it's presented in all of the major machines that control us. But of course, my forte is the 16 years I've spent in Hollywood. So I'll be reverting all of these ideas back to a Hollywood-centric model. And I'm really excited to share this with the folks. I'm also going to demonstrate a lot of hidden imagery in film, even in nice. Disney animation. And I just want to mention quickly, if I may, Josh.
Yeah.
I want to give your listeners and your viewers a quick insight into what Hear the Watchmen is. I am blessed to be very good friends with Mike and Jeannie, who are the coordinators and really the creators of Hear the Watchmen. And what happened, Josh, is 2 years ago, we all convened in Bozeman, Montana. And a fine gentleman named Michael Bennett got together with Steve Quayle and Pastor David Langford, and they created the Whitestone Remnant Conference in Bozeman. It was in late May and early June of 2014. I went out there with my friends from American Survival Wholesale. I was brand new friends with Mike and Jeannie at the time, so we were all getting to know each other. It was a great group of us. We had dinner. We broke bread with Doug and Joe Hagman and got to know them better. I had a great visit with Sheila Zielinski, and you know, we heard from Russ Dizdar and Steve Quayle and Pastor Langford, Coach Dave Daubenmeyer, who will also be at Hear the Watchmen. And it was just a blessed 3 days. It was like this powerful spiritual anointing that came down on the little beautiful town of Bozeman, Montana. So I think that in our hearts, Josh, there was a seed, a mustard seed, if you will, planted at that time to think, you know, this cannot be a one-off. We've got to bring the remnant body of believers together. You know, the remnant, I like to think that we're all sort of the lovers of Jesus Christ, but we're the oddballs. You know, we're the salty dogs. I joke with Mike from Hear the Watchmen often. I look at him and I say, man, brother, when the Lord tapped us, he must have been at the absolute back of his Rolodex. And we always remind each other, God does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called.
Amen.
So back to the Watchmen. Amen. So what happened is last July, in late July of 2015, Mike and Jeannie and myself, as well as Chance and his wife, Merrill from American Survival Wholesale, we all attended one of Paul McGuire's prayer meetings in North Hollywood. And we had met Paul about a year earlier. We had a pretty nice acquaintance with him, and we would always go to his prayer meetings. And you know, Paul would speak for a while, and then there would be a great time of prayer, and there would be a different spiritual power each time, obviously coming from the Most High. And so it was a really great, refreshing thing to do on a Thursday night in L.A.
Well, and John, so hold on, my friend, 1 second. I know 10 minutes goes by really fast. We'll be back, folks, right after this. All right, we're talking to John Robertson, the topic Hollywood and what influences it, or more importantly, how it influences you. Now, John, everybody's going to the Hear the Watchmen, or they're streaming it by now. I mean, if they've been listening to us at all, they're going to be like, well, yeah, I got to be there. But I want to get to this idea, because this is really kind of bugging me. How is Hollywood not just influencing, but predicting some of this stuff? Like we said earlier, you know, when you watch that Simpsons clip of the Donald Trump presidential announcement, it is a frame-for-frame copy of what really happened. So is there some sort of Ouija board that these people are playing with, or what's going on here?
That's an excellent question, Josh, and my goodness, we could run for the rest of the day on that, but suffice it to say this. There's an excellent book, if folks are interested in Hollywood, called The Kid Stays in the Picture, and it's really the biography of Robert Evans, the ginormous producer for Paramount back in the late 60s through the 70s. And he did The Godfather and Apocalypse Now, and Robert Evans, I mean, the guy's he's as big as they come in Hollywood, piled around with all the big names. He and Warren Beatty were buddies, etc. Anyway, that book begins to tell the story of what happened to studios in the late 60s and early 70s. There was a new demographic of creatives coming in, total auteurs, people like Kubrick and Coppola and George Lucas and the whole Malibu crowd. And they kind of came in a Trojan horse that was really shoehorned by Coppola, who had a huge success writing the feature film Patton. Yeah. And Coppola had all kinds of great ideas, and he was a very prolific writer, really a creative genius. And he brought all of these new faces into the Hollywood establishment. Now, at the time, Hollywood was making a lot of really saccharine, kind of campy, big-budget musicals, Hello, Dolly, and so forth. Not to slam that stuff, but it wasn't what people wanted. People wanted gritty. People wanted Taxi Driver, Midnight Cowboy, And these young Turks, if you will, they were bringing it into Hollywood. But another thing happened at that time, Josh, and this is where the whole predictive programming aspect of what you just touched on comes in. Josh, studios have not self-financed since the late 60s, early 70s. If a $200 million feature is being developed at Warner Brothers or Fox or wherever, that money is coming from the same international banking cartels that set the agenda for the White House. I personally believe, this is just my opinion, but I personally believe they give people like Barack Obama his marching orders.
Oh, yeah.
It wouldn't surprise me if some of these heads of the banking cartel families, be it the Rothschilds, Rockefellers, Warburgs, House of Windsor, etc., I wouldn't be surprised if they hang up with Barack Obama and they're on the phone next with the head of development for Warner Brothers. So we know that money talks. And I will tell you from personal experience, and I'd like to take a little bit of time this hour with your permission to talk about some personal experiences, but I will tell you from personal experience, Josh, working primarily in network television the last 6 or 7 years, a lot of runaway feature film production left Hollywood. We had a $330 million corporate welfare package that Governor Brown signed in California last year that's bringing feature film production back. But anyway, most of us that work in town have been on network television for at least the last 5 years. And that's been my primary battleground, if you will. And we receive rewrites every morning before the cameras roll. In fact, before a light goes up, before the talent comes in and rehearses and blocks the scenes, we get rewrites. And sometimes those rewrites, Josh, are mirror images of things that perhaps you or the Hagmans or Steve Quayle or John B. Wells or Rick Wiles were touching on just the day before. Mm-hmm. Now, the question, of course, is what comes first, the chicken or the egg? Let's go back to Adam Weishaupt. One of the basic tenets that he encouraged and talked about is they follow... Many of them follow an Aleister Crowley-esque doctrine known as thelema. That's T-H-E-L-E-M-A. It's the primary doctrine behind OTO, the biggest cult in Hollywood, which is Ordo Templi Orientis. That's a different show. But they believe that we are, in fact, the sheeple. We are the lemmings. We're the herd. We are a 9-digit anonymous tax base. And the sooner we die after retirement, the better. It's a complete eugenics agenda. They actually have the moxie. They have the arrogance, the I would say Luciferian, satanic arrogance. They actually enjoy showing us their hand. They tilt their hand before they do it. Because frankly, Josh...
What are we going to do to stop it?
Well, not only that, but first we have to recognize that it's there. And that's, I think, what gets you and I out of bed every morning. You know, so many people are walking around in an iPhone, iPad, fluoridated prescription pharmaceutical haze that really all they can do is bring home the paycheck, get something on the table for dinner, pop a couple more of the yellow ones and go to bed.
Yep.
You know? And so I think that the first thing I would call upon everyone to do is pay attention to the Josh Tolley Show, pay attention to True News and the Hagman and Hagman Report, Caravan to Midnight, The Weekend Vigilante. That's where you're getting the raw information. And don't take my word for it. Don't take, with no disrespect intended, don't take Josh Tolley's word for it.
Right.
Do your homework. We have, for the first time in the history of humanity, we have the entire world at your fingertips with these little plastic keys.
Yep.
Use discernment. Use the judgment that God gave you, folks, and jump in head first and do your homework. Much of what we talk about is well vetted and it's real. That being said, Josh, let's jump back, with your permission, let's jump back into the Luciferian agenda in Hollywood and see what's going on.
Absolutely.
Well, at Hear the Watchmen, I will be touching on, as I said, you know, it's all roads lead to Babylon. And there is, I think one of the, if I only had 5 minutes to talk to the entire world about what Hollywood does, this is what I would say. Hollywood is the elaborate puppet show that enables the puppet masters, the international bankers, the people behind the monetary power of a George Soros, if you will, okay? And what Hollywood's primary job is to condition the minds, much like Aldous Huxley wrote about in Brave New World, to condition the minds of the populace to not only accept their servitude, but to love it, to kiss the ring, literally. And how do they do this? Well, let's go to the last show that I worked on. I'm very upfront about this. I'll tell your listeners right now. In September of 2015, I took a huge hit. I was banned for life from one of the major studios, one of the three major networks, and a major cable company. Banned for life. I had to sign the papers saying that I can never work for this organization again. And it is one of the six biggies. In fact, it's one of the top two biggest. Anyway, I was working on a show called Superstore. And Superstore is on NBC.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I know that show. Matter of fact, hold on one second, because we have to take another break. But I do know that show. And I thought, well, I won't even get into my own personal opinions of the shows. But stay where you're at, folks, because we have so much more to cover. And you know what, John? I think it's really interesting how all these things kind of tie together. Or as you say, you know, all roads lead to Babylon. So we'll continue this right after the break. All right, we're talking to John Robertson. And now, John, before the break, you were talking about Superstore, a project that you were working on, and you got banned for life from one of the big two studios. So if you could please continue with that story, sir.
Yeah, I want to give people as much information as I can. Folks, I did get banned from one of the big studios, and the line for the tram forms right over here. Okay, there's a clue for you. Yeah, so I was working on Superstore. It stars America Ferrer, who carried the reasonably successful TV show from about, what, 7-8 years ago, Ugly Betty. She played the title role, Ugly Betty. And so I'm going to use Superstore as an example to give people a real tangible insight into this conditioning that I'm talking about. Okay, let me start with this. Back in the 60s, General Electric, GE, worked with Jack Parsons, worked with JPL, mm-hmm. to do a lot of experimentation, Josh, in tonal harmonics and in frequency manipulation and how it affects the electric impulses and the frequencies in our minds. And what they were doing is they were looking for the most effective way to present commercials. Now, everyone in the television business knows that commercials that's what it's all about. I mean, the show, we call it the... So they wanted to figure out, how do we massage the mind to get men to change, aftershaves, or get women to change, I don't know, pantyhose. And what they came up with was brilliant and very effective. They realized that they could disseminate the beta from the alpha waves in the human mind. And that in so doing, they could, through the use of tonal harmonics and the use of flicker rates on television, lull the viewer into a hypnotic state, a state of open availability to suggestion.
Sure.
And they did this originally for commercial enterprise, but then as the eugenicist and as the depopulation scam began to solidify in the 1960s and 70s, they realized that they could do the exact same thing with the programming. So they brought us programs like That Girl and Mary Tyler Moore to do what, Josh? To encourage women to be free and liberated, get out of the home, barefoot in the kitchen, forget it. I'm gonna go run an ad agency, or I'm gonna be a news broadcaster. Well, they were fine shows, but what was really going on is the government needed to double their tax base, and they wanted to simultaneously decimate the nuclear family. That's what was going on, and Hollywood was complicit in it all. Sex it up, make it attractive, empower women to leave their kids at home to become latchkey kids. I was a latchkey kid. It's a bad idea. And to rip apart the nuclear family. Now, we know, Josh, that the nuclear family is the essential building block of civilization as we know it. Without the nuclear family, you can't have civic government, state government, or federal government.
Yep.
So back to Superstore. Superstore is an ensemble cast that they essentially work in a Walmart, okay? Mm-hmm. And to watch these, I think I did 8 episodes of the first season. To watch these people interact, you would think that they were living in LA, making maybe 120 a year, at least 100 a year. But they put on the little blue vest every day, and they work in a Walmart environment. Now, we know the true story of Walmart. God bless the people that work hard at Walmart, but they can't even afford to put a turkey on the table at Thanksgiving.
Exactly.
So what Superstore was doing was it was trivializing and making a comedy, and some of it was pretty witty. Excuse the rhyme. But what it was doing was it was telling young people and impressionable people and everyone sitting in their living room watching TV, that it's okay to work at Walmart. You'll have fun. It's a multicultural good time. While you make, what, $6 an hour trying to live in a city where the average rent is over $2,000 a month?
Yeah.
That's the type of conditioning, Josh, that really concerns me. And it's one of the key factors that has motivated me away from Hollywood. And I'll drop a quick joke on you.
Sure.
The Hagmans, I first was contacted by Joe Hagman last February. And it's interesting because I was standing in the parking lot of MTV. I was working on the show Awkward at the time, basically a teen sex show. and I was bottom feeding at MTV for a couple of months, waiting for another gig to start. And I was talking to Joe Hagman out in the parking lot. He said, John, you want to come on the show tonight and talk with my dad and I about Hollywood? Well, I really wanted to be a guest on the Hagman and Hagman Report. That was a cool transition to go from a caller to a guest. You know, that was something I really wanted to do. Joe offered this, and I said, no, I don't, because I knew if I went on that would be the beginning of the end. Well, I went on anyway, and they bestowed upon me the moniker of the Hollywood Insider. I didn't choose it, but it's kind of stuck with the Hagmans and with Caravan of Midnight.
I bet.
I think, Josh, the good Lord willing, after Hear the Watchmen, I'm going to start going by the Hollywood Outsider.
I love it. You know what's interesting about the influence, though? You're right. I mean, the way Hollywood has influenced things, look at how cheap fatherhood has become. I mean, dads are the butt of every joke. The man in a marriage is the doof. I mean, he's the one that the woman almost has to make up for because the man is so incompetent. And it has destroyed manhood. I mean, when you look at the marriage rates, I mean, seriously, folks, think about this for a second. 48.5% of women 15 to 45 have no children. And you think, well, you know, so what? That is a massive, massive shift in everything when you have half of the women who are completely childless. And you think, well, where did this influence come from? It came from exactly what John was talking about when we started having movies and TV shows about, well, just wait until you're older to have kids or don't have kids or anything like that. So, John, I mean, kind of you kind of planted the seed with, okay, here's the influence. But there has to be people in Hollywood who have spoken out against the influence. Do these people stay around, or are they taken out? Are the conspiracy theories like Brittany Murphy, you know, her and her husband were killed. Like, do they take out the people who disagree?
Yes. And Josh, let me ask you this. How much time do we have till our next break?
About 2 minutes, 45 seconds.
Okay, so let me answer the question. When you look at Brittany Murphy, when you look at Heath Ledger, and when you look across the pond at a death that really bothers me, I discussed this on the July 28th, 2015 Caravan to Midnight, of Peaches Geldof, Bob Geldof's daughter. It just doesn't add up. I mean, something's definitely not passing the smell test. Are there private contracts in Hollywood to take people out that are rocking the boat? You better believe it. And I will offer the listeners just a tease of what I'd like to go into in the next segment. In Hollywood, there are two things that I want to talk about. Number one is the demonic brokerage of actually selling your soul. I know it sounds crazy, folks, but it happens. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about how it happens. And I'm going to touch on it in greater detail here in The Watchmen. And we're going to talk a little bit, Josh, about the most horrific thing I've uncovered, which is called baby breeders.
What is a baby breeder?
There is very strong evidence, both circumstantial and first person, that I've been able to uncover in the past 18 months that from time to time, actual child sacrifice is occurring in Hollywood to offer a blood offering to Satan himself to give success to a given project, typically in the $200 to $300 million production budget.
What? Okay, so yeah. when we have a situation like that, when we have a situation that suggests, you know, Brittany Murphy ends up dying. I mean, 32 years old, great health, boom, she's dead. Then like a week later, her husband dies. And then, you know, you touched on Heath Ledger. What was really weird with that one to me before we hit this break is that the first phone call that the housekeeper makes is not to 911. It's not even to building security. The first phone call was to Ashley Olsen of the Olsen twins. And I'm thinking, how is that even connected? Why would you think, okay, I need to call an Olsen twin? That is just beyond me.
Well, maybe you can ask Robert Wagner in November of 1980 when we lost the beautiful and talented Natalie Wood. The first person he called was his lawyer.
And how many people don't even know Christopher Walken was on that boat? I didn't even know Christopher Walken was on that boat until recently. That's just crazy. All right, stay where you're at, folks. We'll be back right after this. All right, we're talking to John Robertson. Before the break, John, you mentioned two things that just absolutely send chills down people's backs, and that is this idea that, yes, people are selling their soul to the devil to get famous, and there are kids being killed as blood sacrifices in order to make movies successful. Can you dig a little bit deeper on that?
Yes, I will. And let me preface this by saying that I first discussed this, and probably in a little bit greater detail than I can do today, with Doug and Joe Hagman back on June 24th of last year. So if folks want to hear just a little more comprehensive take on this, because this is very serious subject matter. And Josh, look, to be frank, I don't particularly enjoy talking about this on air. I had a number of private discussions with Doug Hagman before I did the show last June to just confirm with him that he understood the gravity of what I was going to discuss on his program. That's how nervous I was about talking about this. So let's start at the beginning. Hollywood is such a tantalizing, narcotic-like center that people, it's not even that they gravitate toward, it's like they're magnetized to it.
Yeah.
And most will do anything to get in that door. Because once you're in the door, as long as you perform, as long as you can bring it, okay, they'll keep you. They'll keep you around. But it's getting in the door that's the challenge. A number of huge stars have openly admitted that they sold their soul to Satan. And that got me looking through scripture and then using my first-person contacts in Hollywood about a year ago to start seriously investigating this. And this is what I discovered, Josh. There are, okay, Satan's, Ephesians 6, 12 tells us that we war not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities. And if you disseminate powers and principalities back to their original languages, you come to understand that Satan's army is built just like an army. He's got generals and colonels and majors, et cetera, all the way down to his privates, to his go-to demons, if you will. And within that army, within that military-like infrastructure, there are actual demonic brokers who will assist when a child of God chooses to sell the most valuable commodity they have, the commodity that both the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and Satan deal in exclusively, which is their soul, for fame. I would encourage the listeners and viewers to take a look on YouTube at Roseanne Barr. Take a look on YouTube at Katy Perry. Take a look at Bob Dylan on 60 Minutes a few years back. And that one really breaks apart because Bob Dylan, you know, back in the early 80s, he released some awesome Christ-centric records. I mean, Slow Train Coming is one of the best records of the 1980s. But apparently he's got a long-term contract with the deceiver. And so rather than go into as much detail as I'd like to, just for expediency's sake, I would encourage folks to look at those huge A-list stars. Look at Bob Dylan. Look at Katy Perry.
Elvis Presley.
Take a look. I hate to slam on the king, but take a look, folks. There's a lot of great material on YouTube, and I just recommend a prayer and spiritual discernment before you dive into it. And let me say one more thing, Josh, before we talk about this horrific baby breeder thing, folks. It's fascinating to chase the darkness, okay? And unfortunately, I'm good at it. Sometimes I feel like I'm good at watching the same car crash over and over and then describing it to people. But I always want to encourage them back to the source, which is in my opinion, which is Christ. So if you subscribe to Christian faith, please seek the Lord God Jesus Christ first and take a look at this dark stuff as a secondary thing, and be very careful. Use great discernment because it is fascinating, and it will hook you. It's like a spar that gets deep within you, and it will drag you in. And it's really easy to spend way too much time chasing the devil and way too little chasing our Savior. I just want to say that before we go into baby breeders.
Wow. Josh, yeah, absolutely true. I agree 100%. Yeah. And I think just real quickly, there have been so many people who get captivated by what the internet calls fear porn. They love to be afraid. They love to be sensationalized. They love to hear these things, and it leads them down some very dangerous territory. And exactly true. You need to know where you're going before you're let the light of the word be the light unto your feet, basically. Okay, keep going. I didn't want to interrupt.
Amen. Well, let's do this. I'm gonna speak for a moment. We'll do the baby breeders in the next segment because it's such an important thing. I don't want to short shrift it. So what I will encourage the listeners and the viewers here of the Josh Tolley Show to do is to always remain solution oriented. And the first place you can start when you want to take a stand and when you want to get in this thing and you want to square your shoulders and stand up, the best place to start is on your knees. And, you know, blow the dust off Granddad's Bible, open it up. There's a reason it's the best selling book of all time and will remain so until the end time.
Yep.
Which may be closer than
I was going to say, which is coming pretty quick.
Yeah, I'm planning on Friday. I think you hear the watchman would be a great time to hear the trumpets. but folks, I like to always present solutions and some solution-oriented stuff. You know, the whole concept of a watchman comes from Ezekiel 33 and also 38, 39. And the watchmen in ancient Israel were an actual rank in the military, and they are in the IDF to this day, by the way. And they stood up on the wall under a command from God himself to serve the people within the walls by keeping a constant vigil for the dust of the approaching enemy on the horizon. Mm-hmm. And the role of a watchman was so important that should they fall asleep on their watch or should they fail to warn those who are within their care inside the walls, that in fact, scripture tells us in Ezekiel 33, that the blood of their fellow men, of their brethren, will be in fact on their hands. So, folks, you have an opportunity, whether it's through the live stream at hearthewatchman.com or by attending this conference, either way, you have an opportunity to be blessed with and to be educated by and to just have fellowship with men and women who are true watchmen, and they're up on that wall every day calling out warnings as they see the dust of that approaching army.
Amen.
And I just can't emphasize that enough. You know, sometimes in our lives, Josh, we need a wall built up between us and our confusion or our sin. And other times in life, we need walls torn down. And I would suggest to everybody listening to this today, come to Dallas this weekend. It's going to be the biggest, baddest wall in the country. And all of the watchmen are going to be standing on it. And they are there to protect you and to serve you and ultimately to serve the Lord God. And I just, again, I think the live stream, Josh, is $29. I know that that Paul McGuire has offered 20% off his book, Prophecy for the Future of America, 2016-17. It's a follow-up to his book from about a year and a half, 2 years ago. All you have to do is sign up for the live stream. You will receive an email from Hear the Watchman. That's at hearthewatchman.com. And in addition to using Josh's promo code to save $50 on admission, if you want to come to the event, You can join us via live stream, $29, and you get 20% off Paul McGuire's book, Prophecy for the Future of America, 2016-2017. And along with Evangelpreneur, it is a must read.
Amen. Absolutely. And, you know, airline flights are so cheap. I was just looking at airline flights to Orlando, $78. So there's no excuse, folks, to say, oh, well, Dallas is so far away. No, it isn't. You can get there from anywhere in the country, anywhere in the world. Just hop on an airplane. It's more affordable than you think. Just go price it, and you'll see that this is worth it. And, you know, beyond that, it's worth it. I don't care if the airline ticket was $500. I mean, what are you really in life to do? What's the point of life? The point of life is to live it more abundantly, and proclaim the gospel, which is the kingdom of God. So if you believe that, go to where you got to go to get the information you need to get to see what's about to happen so you can take it back to everybody else. Whew. All right. All right, so let's do this. I mean, we're only about, you know, 20 seconds away from the break anyway, so let's kind of end it there. I really want to get into this thing that you brought up, which is these baby breeders. That is just flashing me back to what Easter actually stands for, to be honest with you, which is sick and depraved. But we'll cover all that right after this, folks. Don't go anywhere. All right, this is the last segment with John Robertson, and I'm telling you, you got to get to hear the Watchman to hear everything he has to say. Get the live stream, no doubt about it. But John, in the last segment we have, you brought up something that I'm sure has just got everybody at the edge of their seats, and that's this idea of baby breeders for the sole purpose of sacrificing these children to some sort of god or deity or something in order to bless these movies and these Hollywood efforts. Can you just kind of spend a little time and explain that to us?
I will indeed, and thank you for giving me the latitude to discuss this. This is serious business, folks. Okay, it started, Josh, in with the ancient Canaanites and their sacrifice of young children, typically 3 years or younger, to the little G god Moloch. Without going into great biblical description, the quote unquote priests would open up the sort of throat abdomen area of this creepy sort of Baphomet with three eyes and kind of looks like an owl. That's Moloch, one of the two great, you know, quote unquote, god monsters of the Bible, as well as Baal. And what they would do, Josh, is they would throw the innocent children into a furnace that was sort of the abdomen of this large Moloch statue. The priests would pull down chains, and into the furnace they would throw these children. They would do it all day long, throw them in live to be immolated as a sacrifice, typically for either quote unquote atonement or for prosperity, you know, again in food production primarily. And then what they would do is, as these bodies built by the many hundreds in a single day, it would create this perpetual glow, and they would have orgiastic dances, rituals, and sexual misconduct by the glow of the Moloch furnace, as the fat and tissue of these innocent little bodies burn. Mm. That's where it started, and it is unfortunately carried over into modern day Hollywood. This is how it works. I said earlier that that witches call themselves initiates, and they like Satan's army of demons, powers and principalities. They have the country divided up in a militaristic fashion. They have warlocks that preside over geographic areas, and then they have witches, typically multi-generational families. Folks, if you want to hear some interesting stuff about this, go on YouTube and investigate John Todd. J-O-H-N-T-O-D-D. I'll just leave it at that. He came from a multi-generational witchcraft family. And what happens, Josh, is the word will come down to one of the warlocks, to one of the high priests, that there's a big project that needs to be blood anointed, quote unquote. And they will contact one of their initiate families who have a daughter, typically age 12 to 13, and they will pull her from school using any number of excuses, you know, moving to a different state, leaving the country. Sometimes they'll use family emergency type. They pull a young girl from school and they will fly a high priest in from really anywhere all over the world to come into the home and to begin having sexual relations with the minor. And the idea, of course, is to impregnate her. Once she has become pregnant, she is sequestered in the home until she carries the baby to term. And then the baby is typically delivered by a Wicca midwife. Therefore, the innocent little life has no paper trail. There's no birth certificate, obviously no social security number. There's no proof that this life ever existed. There is proof, however, in heaven.
Amen.
These people will answer. They will answer. anyway, there are places in Hollywood. I'm 99% certain I know where one is in Malibu. I'm just going to leave it at that. Dark place, man. Anyway, what they do is they do a Canaanite-esque ritual where they heat a statue of Moloch, a much smaller one. And in order to offer a blood sacrifice to Satan for financial success, for massive distribution of the kind of project that runs 200, 300 million, something that could wipe a studio out almost, they will take an innocent young baby. They prefer males, but they use females as well. And they will take that little life and they'll cast it on a red hot statue of Moloch, and it will immolate, much like a baby in a fry pan. And this happens. I don't know how often. I get nervous talking about it because, well, I don't particularly enjoy talking about it.
I don't blame you. You know, John, I'm just going to say what's interesting about that is I'm sure a lot of people are mad right now just listening to that. But I can't confirm this, but I have had another ex-member of a cult like this say that what they do after they sacrifice the child is they will find a place where a funeral is about to be, and there's already that hole dug, and they will go in there at night, dig a hole underneath the already existing hole, put the dead baby there, because once the vault goes in and the coffin goes in, nobody is ever, ever going to look underneath that grave again. So that's even how they hide these sacrificed children.
Yes, and I'd like to add to that, Josh. There was a gentleman who was on True News with Rick Wiles a couple months ago. People will have to go into the True News archives to find it. He was a former a witch, a practitioner of Satanism, and he did a child sacrifice in a different manner. He was actually he partook in abortions, Josh, where they would use the blood of the aborted life as again sacrificial atonement, to sacrificial, well, we know that life is in the blood,
right?
And you know, some of this I will touch on, some of this at Hear the Watchmen. I don't know what Russ Dizdar is going to speak on, but he has a wealth of knowledge about this as well, as does Paul McGuire, as does Pastor David Langford. It's hard for me to talk about this on air. It's going to be even harder to do it in person, but I'm going to pray it through and I'm going to do it. Understand this, folks. You need to use discernment in your daily life. You need to look at the products of Hollywood with great discernment. I'm not saying never go to the movies. Just use discernment. You know, if you ask God, if you take a step toward Him spiritually, He will always take two toward you, and you're never too far gone for redemption. Trust me. Amen. I wasn't a private in the Army of Darkness. I was at least a captain or a major, Josh. Okay. I didn't go to drug parties. I threw the drug parties. And if the Lord could love me and redeem me, you know, Josh, if the Lord God had given me what I deserved, if He had given me justice, I wouldn't be on this program because I wouldn't be on this earth anymore. But instead, He gave me mercy.
Mm-hmm. That's absolutely true. And there's so many people who get that mercy. The lie of the devil is that there's not forgiveness. The lie of the devil is you have to feel bad and perpetually guilty for what you've done. Because he knows that if he can keep you without hope, then there's no way for you to actually become a mighty warrior against him. And conversely, the Bible says, he that is actually forgiven of more delights more in the forgiveness. So it's actually telling you, man, the worse you are, the better this is going to be for you, to be honest. So come on over. And that's what the devil doesn't want you to realize.
You know, that's exactly the amen, brother. And I'm going to say this, and I'll make this my final point for our effort today, Josh. At Hear the Watchman, we've been blessed with Pastor David Langford, Pastor Billy Crone out of Vegas, and Pastor Flip Benham out of North Carolina. Pastor Flip Benham baptized Norma McCorvey, also known as Jane Roe, of the Roe v. Wade Supreme Court case. I've done multiple shows with Pastor Flip Benham. I would encourage the Josh Tolley listeners to go back to December 21st, Hagman and Hagman Report, where Reverend Flip and I brought two post-abortive women onto the show, and they were so brave, Josh. They actually gave their firsthand testimonies of exactly what you were just talking about, which is that demonic lie that it's hopeless for the sinner. And I'll make this my final comment for today, is that we live in fearful times, and fear is the primary tool of the enemy. It paralyzes, it neutralizes, it makes you impotent. And you have to pray to the Lord God above that he will infuse you with faith, because faith is the antithesis of fear. The two cannot coexist. They're light and darkness. They're oil and water. Come to Hear the Watchman. Join us on live stream if you can't make it personally. I will be there to interact with you folks the entire 3 days, answer tons of questions, pray with you, whatever you need. If you need deliverance, we're going to break bondage at this place. The Holy Spirit's going to be there in force. And folks, when you hear us talk about this kind of stuff, pray to God above, open up your heart and your spirit, and replace that fear weapon with faith.
You know what's interesting? We have less than a minute, and John, I have to thank you for being brave and talking about this stuff and continually going on shows and presentations like Hear the Watchman. But, you know, we really have to get to this point, folks, where we don't just hear this stuff. We do this stuff. There are so many people who love to cheer for the Jesus team. They love to sit in the seats on Sunday and say, "Hallelujah, Jesus," and they'll pray for their pastor. "Yep, pastor, you go win souls. Yes, pastor, you go heal people. Yes, pastor, you go save marriages." But in reality, we have to stop being fans and start actually playing on the team. We have to get in the game. We have to go out there and say, "Hey, you know what? I'm going to pray for that person. I'm going to start talking to this couple about their marriage. I'm going to give a testimony of the gospel of the kingdom." And that's when it becomes actually something you're involved in. Until then, you're just a fan. Folks, that does it for today. Remember, may your path lead to heaven, and may freedom follow in your footsteps.